Hey guys, welcome back. Andrew for Life. Please hit that like button, subscribe button if you haven't already. It means a lot to me and helps the channel tremendously. Now let's get right into it today. We got spoilers. We got big time spoilers because guess what? They're pumping out Berserk chapters like Lil Wayne said in that Fireman song, churning babies. Well, they're churning Berserk chapters and I can't even keep up. I heard July 7th. It's come out, I guess, yesterday. So it really came out July 5th. They're just making these bad boys so fast. So we got chapter 367. Just to clarify, we got the whole 367. Not leaks, not some panels. We got every single panel we need. All right? So, you know, big time spoilers. If you haven't seen the show and then read up to the anime, I suggest everybody in the world go do that. So let's dive right into this, okay? We got some crazy stuff going on right off the rip, right? So Guts, he's looking like pissed, and he's looking angered, and then we got Zod, and Guts and Zod have like this, you know, stare down moment. Of course, Griffith's on the other side, as usual. The chapter's called Mists Fade as Cherry Blossoms Fall. A torrent of darkness seeps in. What will become of this once peaceful island? So Elfhelm is under full-blown attack, okay? And if you guys are really into the Berserk universe, the Berserkosphere, if I may, there's a lot of theories. Before 365 came out, there was a whole bunch of theories that Elfhelm would go under. Elfhelm would be, like, caught on fire, especially if Griffith ever chose to go there. And a lot of people theorize that he would, which he has. People have pointed out that Skull Knight's still on the island. And, you know, we'll get to Skull Knight in a minute in this chapter. So there was a lot that has honestly come to fruition from the Berserk theorists. And it's quite impressive. Like, I just want to give a little tidbit. Channels like Real Life Ryan and tons of other people have really talked about stuff like this and done a fantastic job of it. So I recommend definitely, you know, searching the interwebs for all this stuff because there's some fantastic theories out there, especially after this chapter. Anyways, we see Guts and Zod having the stare off, and as I have seen so many people predict, you know, we're back to the same old recipe of, but now Griffith's on Elfhelm, and he came all the way to Guts and Casca and where they were being peaceful, and we got Zod all up in the mix, Griffith looking with that hawk eye, and then Zod, come on, bring it! Then we got Guts getting attacked by that freaking paw, the claw and the paw of doom, right? It's like the crane from the arcade machines that will actually attach to you, except it'll also kill you once it attaches. Then we see Guts being like, what? And he barely dodges, but of course he does dodge, because he's Guts, like a Gen Z would say, Guts is a Giga Chad, okay? He is a Giga Chad who yeets on his enemies and yeets on the apostles with plenty of riz. Anyways, I appreciate you all staying late to help fill in for the brownies. Don't mention it. Still kind of surprised you run around the village all day doing brownie work. We can be brownies again in the morning, Isidro. No way. Mornings are for training. Oh, well, at least I'll get to keep Isma all to myself. So we get to see Serpico, and we get to see the Elfhelm queen, you know, the powerful mage. And you two should bid Lady Dannon, farewell. We should be on our way. I forgot her name, Lady Dannon, sorry. Night, Lady Dannon. Okay, then she starts shivering, and thud. Nice breeze tonight, Isidro, just so clueless. Is it a tummy ache? You didn't eat anything funny, did you? What ails you, your highness? Hey, what's going on? Everything will be lost. I sense great danger. They shall spring forth from the earth, one after the other. Okay, so she's clearly, Lady Dannon is clearly talking about the apostles, right? I mean, I think that's totally fair to assume. Huh? Isidro and Serpico are, like, confused. Oh my gosh. I read this earlier, but I skimmed it so that I could sort of be aware of what was going on and sort of not be fully aware of every single panel. I was gonna, you know, do it how I'm doing it now in the video. So, my reactions, I assure you, are genuine. My impressed attitude is forthright. This art, guys, I just want to comment. The shadings, the lines, the details, the art, it looks very Miura. And on top of that, I know it's not Miura, but it's so good. They are doing a fucking well done job. It hurts my heart when I see people in the community going back and forth about how the art sucks, how it can't compare, blah, blah, blah. I think the art is, first of all, the art is objectively way above average, okay? If you guys think you can draw better, please make these panels and show the world how much better you can do. Otherwise, just appreciate it like I do, and so many others do as well. Secondly, we all know it's not Miura, but can we not appreciate that it's done in a Miura-esque style, and that it has homage in a creative and skillful artistic way to Miura? I mean, that's all we could really ask for, right? It's amazing. Anyways, yeah, this panel just really shocked me. I thought this was a great panel. Even without the eyes, yes. I just think they nailed the worry, the tense shoulders, the gripping of Casca, Griffith, walking. Okay, so Guts, he sees that Casca's like in danger because Griffith is deciding to walk over to her, but Zod's not. He's pissed. He's pissed. He doesn't want Griffith to even think about. I mean, he doesn't want Guts to even think about Griffith. Now Guts is zooming over towards Griffith, lightning fucking speed, and he comes up behind ready to chop his head off when, what's this? Oh, snap. I couldn't tell earlier if this was Griffith using femto powers to deflect Guts' blade, or if it's Guts' blade stopping on purpose because Casca. I think it is him stopping on purpose because of the sweat beads, and I think that the sweat beads are implying like he's nervous because he almost just sliced, but he was able to stop himself, like that, you know, your gut drops feeling. And actually, as I'm looking at this, I'm thinking more and more about it. I think Guts 100% stopped it on his own, because this is sort of like paying homage to the scene from when Guts and Griffith fight, when Guts wants to find his own dream and his own path in the world. If you guys remember, Guts and Griffith have a fight when Guts first leaves the Band of the Hawk. And Griffith loses that duel, that interaction, in a humiliating fashion. Guts has to stop himself from cutting Griffith in half, despite Griffith in his head being willing, going the distance of being willing to kill Guts. Like, Guts was able to stop and clearly outpowered him. So here we see that Guts is stopping his blade, in my opinion. What? And it's for Casca's benefit, right? Which makes total sense. Dang, that panel is so nuts, you guys. Look at that. The detail on the sword, the way that it's like in your face, and then we get this shot, this angle, coming back on the whole scene of what's going on. Get some Elfhelm setting in the background going on. What is it, the Tree of Life or whatever? Okay, so now, okay, we fast forward and Guts is sort of like swung his sword, and then he's, I guess, confused maybe, or just really pissed, or thinking. It looks like he's just contemplating, which I would be too. And then somehow the entire Elfhelm Island is breaking apart in giant landmass chunks, right? Farnese and Shere Khan are hanging on for dear life as the island is falling into a chaotic war zone, apparently. I thought this was people initially, but I could clearly see it's just tree roots. And we have naked Finboy Griffith holding on to his used and abused mistress, Casca, who just can't seem to catch a break. Jeez. And then we've got Casca unconscious in Griffith's hands, Zod behind him. The island's peaceful routine has been upset. Berserk will resume August 12th. Realistically, that probably means like August 1st at this rate, but guys, that was a crazy chapter, okay? That's insane. I don't know why Griffith is going for Casca. It's like, it's almost like Griffith, it's almost like what R-word in Casca, what he did to her wasn't enough. Killing the entire band of the Hawk wasn't enough. Humiliating Guts wasn't enough. Overpowering him in multiple fights and scenarios, it's not enough. He has to come to where they're just chilling, trying to get a moment of peace, and disturb not only Guts and Casca's lives over and over again, but Griffith has to try and destroy the most peaceful place left on Earth. And it's just so evil, and it's so manipulative, and it just shows. I really think this chapter has revealed a new thing about Griffith, which I consider to be a big deal, because part of the appeal is Griffith's such an interesting and dynamic character, and there's so much nuance to him and what goes down, and generally people agree he is very evil, but a lot of people, you know, there's the whole meme, Griffith did nothing wrong, right? And a lot of people do sympathize with him, because Miura did such a good job writing the story. Like, we really, as the audience, can sympathize with Griffith up until a certain point. We could sympathize with him hard. And I would even argue we could sympathize with him all the way up until he commits R-word on Casca. And after that, it's just like, all right, dude, you sort of lost your daggum mind. I mean, you, whatever point you were trying to make, whatever good you were trying to do, you've gone so far, you've gone the other way. Like, you went so far, you like looped back, but for the worse, not the better, you know, for the worse, not the better. So I think, what I was saying is, I think this reveals that Griffith, he might have always had some plan with Casca and Guts, and maybe in the next couple of chapters, it will be revealed that he let them escape the eclipse, and maybe we'll get more details on how Skull Knight was able to save them when Skull Knight really couldn't do shit. Like, if we really think about the practicality of the God Hand and their powers, Femto could have just... he probably could have stopped them from escaping. So, I think what this is revealing is either a new level of petty for Griffith, right? Or it's revealing... or maybe it's both, but it could also be revealing a new level of evil for Griffith. And then lastly, since we don't know what's going to happen, maybe Griffith, like, takes Casca and, like, erases her memory and, like, heals her trauma or does something like that. I mean, that's very theoretical, and I'm not trying to get too crazy into the theories, but I just think that this is showing us that potentially Griffith always had more in store for his beloved Casca and Guts that he loves to use and abuse, and the people in his life who were truly relevant. Maybe this all stems from some stuff that happened in the Golden Age that he thought through, or maybe during the eclipse or after, he like really put a lot of thought and like planned whatever's happening out. I definitely think that It's unique, right? It's interesting. It's, damn. It's so sad. It's upsetting. It's dynamic that Griffith is coming back to them. I think it says a lot about Griffith. I think this chapter reveals, like, he is on a level of evil that maybe the audience hasn't even been wanting to accept up until now. Like, he's so damn evil, he'll go to the last good place on Earth he hasn't completely manipulated, and he's going to turn that place into a fucking war zone for his own benefit, even at the cost of Guts and Casca again and again and again and again. It doesn't matter how many times he fucks with your life or ruins what you're doing. He will do it again and again with no remorse, no hesitation, and he will seek you out like a heat-seeking missile or some shit of evil, you know? Like, I really do think this chapter was dynamic and huge for our character Griffith. I think it reveals, if he doesn't do anything good with Casca, I think it shows how petty and evil he is, if not petty, at least evil. I think it shows how in-depth intellectually he has gone with planning evil things out. I feel like a lot of people still have hope for Griffith, that maybe he could come back, that maybe he could do some right, maybe Griffith will be the one who defeats the God Hands, and that could still could be the case. But Miura, or Miura's best friend and his assistants, depending on how accurate this is to what Miura wanted in the original story, they are really driving home the point that Griffith's an evil piece of shit. And I... Hey, correct me if I'm wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. But I was, I felt well established that Griffith was a terrible human, right? I was pretty confident in that opinion. And the video that has 4 million views that says he did nothing wrong did not convince me otherwise. So, for the sake of storytelling, I really feel like they have established a truly evil, fucked up villain, Griffith. And now, he's just doing even more shit to our main characters we sympathize and love and empathize with so much. Especially Casca. After everything she went through. After being brutally R-worded by not just Griffith, but his apostles too. After losing her memory for so long. After coming back to the light due to a miracle. Due to Guts and his team and a miracle by the Elf Island mage, Lady Dannon. Like, all the stuff that it took to even get here is crazy. And now there's more bad shit happening to her and Guts. Like, Guts is a victim too because he loves this woman. And now he's having to go even further down the rabbit hole of saving this woman he loves. I mean, it's so crazy, right? What a crazy chapter. I'm so happy. I'm so damn happy. Give it up, give it up. This is great. I really want to see what happens next. I hope you guys enjoy these videos, the updates. I'm going to try to stay all over these updates. They are churning babies, like I said, like the Lil Wayne song. They are churning volumes and chapters of Berserk like it's Madman season. And I'm just going to try and stay on top of it. Thank you guys again. If you made it to this point in the video, you're the best person I personally know. You're the best person ever, period. Please like and subscribe. I always like to start and end with that, just because it truly helps me. It helps me enter that wave that is the algorithm on YouTube and get any attention, get any respect for the videos I do, get any recognition. And I'm just so appreciative of anybody that, you know, helps me out in that way. And I'm so appreciative of people who even don't, who just watch or just watch a couple seconds of. So, thank you, but please, if you can, if you want to, if you like the content, hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, and I will be churning out more content, just like they're churning out Berserk volumes and chapters. Thank you guys so much. I hope y'all like the chapter. I hope y'all like the art. I hope y'all are satisfied with the direction of the story, the artistic ability expressed, and I hope you guys truly are struggling on strugglers. Peace.